The Christian in Complete Armor by William Grinnell. Ephesians chapter 6, verse 18, chapter 52. A threefold dissimilitude to be made in our request. First, temporal blessings are chiefly to be desired for the sake of spiritual. The traveler desires a horse, not for itself so much as for the conveniency of the journey he has to go. Thus, the Christian, when praying for temporal things, should he desire them as helps in his way in passage to heaven. I do not say it is unlawful to desire life, health, and other comforts of this life, for the suitableness of these have to our natural affections and to supply our outward necessities. But to desire them only for this is low and base. It is the mere cry of the creature. The ravens thus cry, and all the beasts of the field seek their meat of God. That is, they desire the preservation of their lives and make their moan when they want that which should support them. And these creatures, being made for no higher end than the enjoyment of these particular good things, observe the law of their creation. But thou art an intelligent being, and by thy immortal soul, which is a spiritual substance, thou art as near akin to the angels in heaven as thou art by the meaner bodily part to the beast, yea, allied to God thy Maker, not only made by him as they were, but for him. He is thy chief good, and therefore thou infinitely dishonors him if thy desires can be satisfied with anything short of him. Thus shouldest thou say, O Lord, as all my gifts and services do not please thee, except with them I give thee myself, so none of these gifts of thy bounty can contend me, except with them thou wilt bestow thyself on me. Now, this regular motion of the heart is praying for temporals is to be found only in those whose inward powers are set right by divine grace. Man in his corrupt state is like Nebuchadnezzar. He hath a beast heart that craves no more than the satisfaction of his sensual appetites. But when renewed by grace, then his understanding returns to him, by which he is enabled, in praying for temporals, to elevate his desires to a nobler end. Doth David pray that some further time may be added to his temporal life? It is not out of a fond love of this world, but to prepare himself for the better for another. O spare me that I may recover strength before I go hence, and be no more. Psalms 39, verse 13. Is he comforted with hopes of a longer stay here? It is not this world's carnal pleasures that kindle this joy in his holy breast, but the advantage that thereby he shall have for praising God in the land of the living. Hope thou in God, for I shall yet praise him, who is the health of my countenance and my God. Psalms 42, verse 11. The saint hath as quick a sense to taste the sweetness of her temporal mercy as another, but his heart being spiritual and so acquainted with higher enjoyments, he desires that God would not put him off with these shells of blessings. Oh, how few thus pray for temporals! Some pray for temporal mercies, which, if granted, would only serve to satisfy their lusts. Ye ask amiss that ye may consume it upon your lusts. James 4:3. One is sick and prays for health, that he may be again at his pots or harlots. Another is childless, and he would have an heir to uphold the pride and grandeur of his house, but not the increase of Christ's family in the world. A third would be a greater man in the world, and for what? May be that having more power, he may take the fuller revenge on his enemies, who now are out of his reach, and others that bring not their sacrifice with so evil a mind, yet look no higher than their carnal contentment in the enjoyment they would have. Thus mariners, Psalms 107, verse 28, cry unto the Lord in their trouble, and when they have their life given them, now they are glad because they are quiet, and God hears no more of them now their turn to serve, a plain evidence they were carnal in their prayer before this mercy, because they improve it not for a spiritual end, which makes the psalmist break forth, verse 31. Oh, that men would praise the Lord for his goodness! But much more abominable is it to pray for spiritual mercies for the sake of some temporal advantage we hope to have by them. Thus Simon Magnus desired the gifts of the Holy Spirit that he might be famous. And do not some make a profession of the gospel with no other view than to improve their trade? Others pray for the assistance of the Spirit and project their own praise by the means, basely perverting those holy things to secular advantages. O horrid baseness, as if one should desire a prince's robe to stop an oven with it. This is to make God the stirrup and the creature our saddle. Those spiritual blessings which are intrinsical in our happiness and indispensable and necessary to our salvation, these we are to pray for with an undeniable importunity. Such are pardon of sin, the love and favor of God, and the sanctifying graces of the Spirit. To be cold or indifferent in our prayers for these is great wickedness. The promise will bear us out of our greatest importunity. Psalms 105, verse 4. Seek ye the Lord in his strength. Seek his face evermore. Revelations 22:17. Whosoever will, let him take the water of life freely. Nothing loses us these mercies more than weak velleities and faint desires of them. But our prayers for temporal blessings must be with a latitude of submission to the will of God, because we are promised conditionally. The promise is the foundation of our faith. The superstructure, therefore, of our prayers must be not go beyond it. This was Israel's sin. Who shall give us flesh to eat? Numbers 11:18. God had indeed promised to feed them in the wilderness, but not to give them every dish their wanton palate craved. And, therefore, when they are dissatisfied with God's bill of fare and cry for flesh, they have their desire, but sour sauce with it. For while their meat was yet in their mouths, the wrath of God came upon them and slew the fattest of them. Psalms 78, verse 31. Thus they were fed for the slaughter by the meat they inordinately lusted after. O take heed of peremptory prayers for their temporal enjoyment, for thereby thou beggest but a rod for thy own back. Rachel must have children or else she dies, and she at last hath two, but dies in travail. It was a smart saying of one of his wife, who passionately desired a son and had one at last, but none the wisest. Wife, saith he, thou hast long passionately desired a boy, and now thou hast one that will always be a boy. God may justly set some print of his anger on that mercy, while he answers our peremptory prayers with, why, alas, must we have that which we must needs lose or shall not enjoy while we have it? Thirdly, those spiritual blessings that are intrinsically to the saint's happiness are to be prayed for with boundless desires, not, give me thus much grace and I will trouble thee no more. No, God gives a little grace not to stop our mouth, but to open it wider. Yet, alas, how very reasonable are most in this particular. So much holiness contends them as will, like salt, keep them from putrefying in gross sins, that they be not unsavory to the nostrils of their neighbors, or as will save them from the lash of tormenting conscience, like schoolboys. They care for no more of their lesson than will save a whipping. Alas, this is not to desire it at all. It is thy credit abroad and thy quiet within thou desirest. He that knows the true worth of grace thinks he hath never enough till satisfied with it in glory. Paul had more than many of his brethren, yet he prays and presses hard after more. Philippians 3, verse 13 and 14. But in temporal enjoyments we are to curb our desires and not let out all the sails of our affections when praying for them. A gracious heart is as unwilling to have too much of these as too little. Give me neither poverty nor riches. Feed me with food convenient for me. Proverbs 30, verse 8. There is not a saint but could cheerfully say amen to this prayer of Agur. The nature of these temporal good things is enough to convince any wise man, and the meanest is best. They are not the Christian freight, but his ballast, and therefore are to be desired to pose, not load the vessel. They are not his portion, but his spending money in his journey, and no wise traveler desires to carry any more money about him than will defray his expenses. End of chapter 52.